Welcome to Lord of Life Church. I'm Pastor Matt, and I'm so thankful you have tuned in to worship with us online. Today's service is recorded in 4K video. Hopefully you'll notice an increase in video quality. And the service is divided by chapters. I invite you to stay with us for the whole service or go to the chapter of your choice. I'll preach on John chapter 11, when Christ raises his friend Lazarus from the dead. It's a mighty miracle that applies directly to our lives today. We'll unite our hearts in prayer as we pray the Lord's Prayer. We'll hear the word of God read to us. We'll hear a message applied to our lives. We'll sing to the Lord, and we'll receive a blessing at the end. There's a lot happening as we approach Holy Week. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and then Maundy Thursday service, Good Friday service, and then Easter service on April 9th. I invite you to join us for Holy Week as we celebrate and thank God for the work that he accomplished for our salvation. I invite you to give to support the work of God's kingdom by supporting Lord of Life Church financially. You can do so by visiting our website, lolchurch.net. Click on Give in the upper right-hand corner, and there you'll be prompted to give a one-time gift. You can watch this short tutorial to learn how to set up a recurring gift online. Also, you can give by text. Simply text this number, 630-381-1199. Type the word give, and you'll be prompted to give either a one-time or a recurring gift right from your device. It's safe, it's secure, and it's convenient to support the Lord's ministry. Thank you so much for your partnership in the gospel, for your support of Lord of Life Church. God is using our church in a big way to make disciples of Jesus. Here are a few photos from the youth retreat that happened a few weeks ago. And Brian gave an update in person last Sunday. And I just want to share these photos with you as they enjoyed the community there, as they worshiped the Lord with chapel, and as they celebrated God's love for them. God is good. So thank you again. You help us make disciples of all ages. Let's now unite our hearts in prayer. Please join me as we pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We now sing to the Lord.
Garden alone, where the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear calling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he touch their singing, and the melody they gave to me within my heart is ringing, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells as we tarry there, none other has ever known. In a garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go to the voice of woe, and his voice to me is calling. And he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
The first reading is from 1 Peter chapter 5. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power, forever and ever. Amen. The gospel reading is from John chapter 11. This is the account of Jesus raising his friend Lazarus from the dead. Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." Before I begin, please subscribe to our YouTube channel below. That helps us reach more people for Jesus. It unlocks features of our channel. Just click the subscribe button and the bell next to it. That way you know when the next devotion or service is available. Please let me know what you think about John chapter 11 in the comments section below. I'd love to hear from you. Let's begin with prayer. Lord God, thank you so much for Jesus who raises the dead. Help us, Lord, to understand the deeper meaning of this miracle. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Today, I'll preach on John chapter 11, when Christ raises his friend Lazarus from the dead. It's one of my favorite chapters in the whole Bible, and I often use it at funerals because it's filled with hope, and we all need hope today. A dead person in the grave for 4 days is raised to life, and since Christ can raise someone from the dead who has been in the tomb for 4 days, he can certainly raise everyone from the dead on the last day, which he promises to do. In John, he said, "Do not be amazed at this, for the hour is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out." This passage is also filled with great emotion. The crowds, the sisters of Lazarus, Jesus wept. There's so much in here that helps us to relate with Jesus. John tells us that Jesus was deeply moved in spirit and troubled, and he wept bitterly. Those two words, Jesus wept, are a license from God for us to cry. I wept uncontrollably last Sunday at the beginning of the 8:30 prayers. I announced the death of two children connected to our church family. Crying is a healthy part of the grieving process. God gives us tear ducts to laugh and to cry. Men, I want to speak to you. It's okay to cry. You're still manly if you cry. Jesus cried. And God will catch our tears. Later in Revelation, God gave this promise about his return when he will catch our tears and wipe them away. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the former things have passed away. It's also filled with promise. Jesus tells Martha, the sister of the dead man, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live even though he dies. That's the promise of eternal life for all who believe. It's filled with power. Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man came out. One day, Christ will say with a loud voice, get up, come out. And everyone will come out of their grave and hear the sound of his voice. Cemeteries will be loud, busy places as caskets pop open. The power of God, the power of Christ's words give life. This miracle is also comforting because Jesus truly cares. He relates with our pain, sadness, and suffering. Isaiah the prophet described Jesus in this way. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. He was a man of sorrows. He knows what it feels like. He knows the hurt. He has felt the pain. One unique part of Christianity is that God, who created the whole universe, he has no end. He became human. He became one of us. And he experienced great loss. He knows what family dysfunction feels like, betrayal, the loss of life, threats against his own life from the time he was a baby. He listens and he cares for us today. He's felt it and he does something about it. In this world, he says, you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. Death is not the end, and that's clear from this miracle. Jesus looks at Martha and makes this very bold claim, I am the resurrection and the life. Today, we'll explore this passage and apply it to our lives. I'll share applications for your life, so I invite you to take notes as we go along today. The first lesson from John chapter 11 is to trust God's timing when he says, wait. Have you ever been disappointed in God's timing? You pray for something and it doesn't happen right away. You might still be praying for it. Maybe you're waiting to be hired, or maybe you're single and you're waiting to meet the right person to marry. Maybe you look at the world and you say, God, why are you waiting? I often say, God, why are you waiting? And he leads me to scripture and he answers that. The Apostle Paul wrote to Timothy and said, I was shown mercy so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his unlimited patience as an example for those who would believe on him and receive eternal life. With this verse, God immediately teaches us to be patient in our relationships and to be patient with him when we ask him for something. God has three answers when we ask him for help. It's yes, no, and wait. In John chapter 11, we get a clear example of God's answer, wait. Jesus is teaching in an area known as Perea, as you can see here on this map. He gets word that Lazarus is sick, and he waits there. And finally, he arrives at the tomb, which is 1.5 miles east of Jerusalem. The tomb is located in a cemetery that dates back to the first century. Several churches have been built on the site, and today it's a tourist attraction. The sacred site is claimed by both Christians and Muslims, and today there is a mosque built on the site of the tomb. Suddenly, Lazarus's sisters, Martha and Mary, send word to him that their brother is sick. Lord, the one you love is sick. The sick person is Jesus' best friend, Lazarus, and the sisters have seen Jesus perform mighty miracles. In fact, they've seen him raise people from the dead. So they have big expectations of what he will do for Lazarus. They believed in his ability to help. They have seen it for themselves. So Jesus knows the family well, and he loves them. They're like family. They're close friends, very close. Certainly, he'd come through fast for them in their time of need. Jesus tells the messengers, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." That's good news to know, but he still doesn't go immediately. We still don't know his timing of when he will heal Lazarus. Will he leave right away to help him? Look at this. John wrote, "Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, yet when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. He really loves them, but 2 more days? Sometimes God says wait because there's something bigger that he will accomplish for his good purpose, and we don't see it yet. This sickness and death of Lazarus will be used by God to glorify his son Jesus, so that many more will believe and have life in his name. Many people will put their faith in Jesus after Christ performs this miracle. So when God says wait, he's got a bigger purpose in mind. I want to say that again. When God says wait, he's got a bigger purpose in mind. One that we don't understand right away. Mary and Martha didn't understand why Jesus waited. When Jesus finally arrives, Lazarus is dead. Martha runs to him and cries out, "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died." It's really difficult to wait on God, isn't it? To wait, to not move in with a fiancé before marriage. It's difficult to wait to pay off college debt. It's difficult to wait for spring, but it's finally here. Praise the Lord. In our house, we're teaching our 4 children to wait and save up their money to buy something that they really want later. Something bigger, something that will take some savings. When they get birthday money, it burns a hole in their pocket right away. Do you remember that growing up? Waiting on God gets emotional like any of these emotions, right? We get frustrated, discouraged, angry, confused. Waiting on God, though, should lead us to trust him, knowing that he has a bigger purpose in mind. In my own life, waiting on God has proved rewarding, but in the moment, it was terribly difficult. What about you? Waiting on God is a test of faith. To trust God and to trust his timing, do you find it hard to wait on God? So what should you do while you wait? Thankfully, Martha, the sister of the dead man, is an excellent example for us of what we should do while we wait. Here are 3 God-pleasing responses when God says to wait. First, don't give up on God. Martha didn't give up on God. She cried out even when her brother was dead, even when God didn't help her as she expected. King David was told to wait on several occasions. Wait to become king of Israel. Wait to defeat his enemies in battle. Wait to build the temple of Jerusalem. Wait for the promised Messiah. In fact, Many of the Psalms that David wrote are prayers while waiting. Psalm 5, verse 3, "In the morning, Lord, you hear my voice. In the morning, I lay my request before you and wait expectantly." So don't give up on God when he says wait. Second, Martha teaches us to continue to ask for help while we wait. She continues to ask Jesus for help. She says, "But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. I know it's not too late. You can still do it." I remember asking God for a wife, for him to reveal the right woman for me to marry. And I kept getting the same answer, wait. I went to a college in Nebraska where there was a 7-to-1 ratio, women to men. During the first day of college, during orientation, the dean of student life told the men to look around the room because the woman you will marry is probably on campus. Many of my friends got married during college, but not me. I had several breakups. I continued to ask him, "Lord, make it clear who you want me to marry." I searched his word and I prayed for her, even though I hadn't met her. And finally, God revealed her to me, and I met Amy. And I'm so thankful that I waited on the Lord. We've been married 15 years, and Saturday will be her birthday. What are you waiting for on God? Don't stop asking. Don't stop asking God for help. Then Jesus tells Martha good news about the future. Your brother will rise again, and she makes a great confession. She says, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." This statement is amazing because Martha sees the bigger picture, God's bigger plan. God has a much bigger plan, and he will work out all things for the good of those who love him. That's a promise from the book of Romans. In the moment, it's difficult to see the bigger picture, especially with all of our emotions. The hope of the final resurrection. It makes me think of a video I recently showed our children of a man painting while singing the national anthem at a basketball game. As he paints, you'll be able to see the bigger picture, and you'll be completely amazed at his painting. Here, take a look. Isn't that awesome? Then Jesus gives Martha a promise that has been engraved on countless gravestones. "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die." Do you believe this? This promise has motivated Christians to endure death and despair in this world because Their eternal life is secure in Christ. And this is what moved early Christians to face excruciating persecution. Lions in the Roman Colosseum, the sword of Emperor Nero, the plague and the famine to help people suffering in the Roman Empire. It's the promise of the resurrection, the promise of eternal life. Jesus then asks Martha the question of all questions, do you believe this? It's the eternal question that we can't avoid even 2,000 years later. It's where the rubber hits the road. It's the question of all questions, with eternal consequences waiting in the balance. So I ask you today, do you believe this? I share the gospel message with people at funerals, and then I ask them the question, do you believe this? Christ said, I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. What he's asking is, do you believe in me even if I don't raise your brother from the dead? When death is in the room, do you believe in me? When things don't happen according to your timing, do you believe in me? When you have uncontrollable tears, when the world is turning away from God at a rapid pace, do you believe in me? I continue to get emails and articles about how Christianity is in decline in America. It's easy to get discouraged, but church, don't get discouraged. The devil wants you to get discouraged. That's part of his scheme. Instead, realize that there's work to do today, that the harvest is plentiful and the workers are few. So ask the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest field, and you yourself be one of those workers. If you answered, yes, I believe, then you have crossed over from death to life, and you have eternal life now, not just when you get to heaven or not just when Christ returns, but right now. And it's time that we live and match up with that eternal life by the way we live, with a moral, God-pleasing life that shares the gospel with obeying God's commands and loving our neighbor. Martha gives one of the most incredible confessions of faith. She says, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who was to come into the world. That's exactly the response that Jesus wants from you and from me while we wait. So would you say it with me? Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who was to come into the world. It's one thing to confess Jesus when times are good. It's another thing when they're not. That's the faith that God wants inside of all of us. And Martha is an incredible example. Finally, Martha's sister Mary comes out to meet with Jesus, and a large, huge crowd of Jews joins her. All of them are weeping bitterly, and he asks Mary, "Where have you laid him?" She brings him to the tomb. John writes two of the most comforting words in the Bible, "Jesus wept." If you've ever cried at the death of a loved one, Jesus has cried too. We have a God who cries and who cares. This portrait of God contrasts greatly with the Greek concept of God that was very popular in Jesus' day, a God with no emotions, a God with no human involvement. We see many of Jesus' emotions here: compassion, indignation, sorrow. When Jesus cries, the Jews say to themselves, "See how he loved them?" They knew he cared because of his tears. Then Jesus arrives at the tomb, and tombs in this time were usually caves carved in limestone rock on a hillside. A tomb was often large enough for people to walk inside. Several bodies would be placed in one tomb. After burial, a large stone was rolled over the entrance to the tomb. Jesus immediately tells them, "Take away the stone." Martha says to Jesus, "But Lord, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days." In other words, it's too late. He's already dead. His body is decomposing. But he reminds them of his promise. "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So he prayed to heaven, and then he yelled in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" If he simply said, "Come out," everyone would come to life at the sound of his voice. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face, and Jesus said, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." At that moment, many of the Jews put their faith in Christ. Many Jews followed him on Palm Sunday to Jerusalem, and they shouted, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord." But they won't see the big picture until after Easter. Jesus himself will die and go into the tomb for 3 days, and God himself will raise him from the dead for us and for our salvation. Oh, the joy for Martha, for Mary, for Lazarus to be reunited again as family. Because of Christ's resurrection, we also will be reunited with those who have died in the Lord. We'll be reunited with our family in Christ, and we'll be together forever. Thanks be to God. To close today, here are 3 lessons we learn from Martha and Mary about waiting on the Lord. Don't give up on God. Continue to ask for help and see the bigger picture. When God says wait, he's got a greater purpose in mind. Last Sunday, we prayed for a family in our congregation who lost their newborn baby shortly after birth. He passed away. I performed the funeral service on Tuesday at a local cemetery in St. Charles. The family requested a specific song of comfort that has brought me comfort during a heavy week and also to my family. I played this song for my family during dinner last week, and they loved it. You might know it, "Come to Jesus" by Chris Rice. It's a song of hope that turns our attention to Jesus, whatever the circumstance, especially while we're waiting. I invite you to sing along. The point of the song is to come to Jesus and have life. Whatever the circumstance, come to Jesus and live. Lord, thank you for the hope of eternal life and the grace of Almighty God. Thank you for helping us see in death the gate to eternal life. We trust you and we love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Sinner, lost and left to die. Raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. And like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. And remember, when you walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. deep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Oh, and when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus and live. And with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye, then go in peace and laugh on glory's side, and fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live. Fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, Jesus and live.
Hello, Lord of Life. I'm Jared Olson. I'm one of our seven elders here. Thank you, Pastor, for your awesome message and our worship team for your gifts of music. Join me as we go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come before you today, some of us broken, some of us worn down and weary, struggling to see the light you bring to our world. Give us eyes to see your blessings, Lord, and ears to hear of your works, in good times and in bad. Give us the wisdom to choose you over this world and not let our own ambitions take over. Be with those struggling with health, mental illness, addiction, financial struggles. Be with our preschool as they mourn a great loss, and others in our church as they grieve over loss as well. Be with our mission of the month, C24/7, as they do awesome things in their community for you, Lord. Be with the leaders of this world. Give them wisdom and guidance. Lift us all up in your wings, knowing we will rejoice with you one day in your kingdom. It's in the wonderful name of Jesus that we pray these things. Amen.
Thank you, Jared. Next week is Palm Sunday, and it's the beginning of Holy Week as Jesus enters into Jerusalem on a donkey to begin the week of our salvation. So I invite you to join us here online or in person next week for Palm Sunday worship. Go now with the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.